several more cases which demonstrates more obvious forms of extrathyroidal spread. Yes, so the right lobe had two nodules or two nodular masses, both proved to be benign on histopathology, a moderately hyperchoric one and a deeply or mixed hyperchoric cystic nodule. And this proved to be papillary cancer, which invaded again the soft tissue. So this is a very suspicious presentation. It has abutting contours, bulges more than 3 millimeters up to the ventral part of the thyroid. Here is the most ventral part of the lobe, and here is the most ventral part of the lobe. We cannot diagnose that this broke into the soft tissue, but it is very considerable that this tumor broke into the strap muscle. In this case, the longitudinal scan, but no, not only the longitudinal scan. So this presentation is very suspicious. Do you agree with me?
Yes.
Okay. Yes.
The discontinuation of the capsule.
Yes. I present another case. Yes, it is very good for comparison. So two nodules, this proved to be this benign, and this medial one proved to be malignant. So we always rely on the entire presentation of a nodule. I stopped the video, so this should not cause concern. Although this nodule presents bulging contours, the capsule is discontinuous, but the entire presentation of this nodule is not suspicious. This is the benign nodule, and this is the malignant. One more consideration. We talked about the nodule borders, and as you remember, the blurred borders are not involved in suspicious signs, but blurred borders has relevance in the diagnosis of papillary cancer. And these blurred borders are suspicious, not enlisted among suspicious signs, but similarly to chaotic vascular pattern, a blurred border of a nodule raises our suspicion. Naturally, this nodule had microcalcification also, and here broke into the strap muscle. It is very suspicious that this nodule spreads extrathyroidal. And this is why minimal extrathyroidal extension in this circumstance, ultrasound has a more than 90% positive predictive value. But if a nodule breaks into the muscle fiber, it is a minimal degree of extrathyroidal spread. So beyond the muscle fiber, here starts the growth extrathyroidal extension. So we can see in a significant proportion of papillary cancers this type of extrathyroidal extension, and we hit that such nodules spread extrathyroidal extension, but unfortunately this has no relevance after the 8th edition of TNM classification. If a tumor invades far beyond to this level, here starts the gross extrathyroidal extension, and for the judgment of such degree of extrathyroidal spread, the positive predictive value of ultrasound is less than 50%. Comments, questions regarding this case?
Sorry.
Please.
I have a question. The shape of this nodule,
the shape
nodule is taller than
maybe it is very, very, very close to the taller than wide side. It is almost equal the ratio of this diameter and this, but maybe it exceeds. It must be measured on this view. I cannot judge whether the depth would exceed the width, but it is a reasonable assumption. I cannot remember what were the correct measures in this case, but it can raise the suspicion. Okay, and I have one more final case. I choose this one. So I do not ask you because you know the answer. This patient had Hashimoto's thyroiditis and presented with an econormal nodule in the dorsal part of the lobe. This was a complex lesion. It reminds me on the pseudonodular appearance of Hashimoto's thyroiditis, but this case proved to be a papillary cancer. So once more, and here I stop the video. This tumor broke again into the trachea. This type of gross extrathyroidal extension is very difficult or even impossible to judge, but this tumor broke into the trachea. And this is not a rare kind of extrathyroidal spread, but ultrasound is not able to diagnose with enough specificity or enough positive predictive value. And another one, the nodule was had only a limited number of vessels. This so-called perinodular vascularity cannot be regarded as perinodular vascularity because the extranodular tissue had increased vascularity. So the vascular pattern of this nodule is corresponds to type 3 intranodular vascular pattern, not a suspicious one, but this should not be regarded as perinodular vascularity, only the normal or extrathyroidal extra nodular tissue had increased vascularity. So once
is
more
it follicular variant?
Please,
is it follicular variant?
No, it was again please, I don't know the correct answer, but if you have 1 minute, I will find the case and I can answer your question.
It looks like a follicular tumor. I thought.
No. Histopathology, I read the final diagnosis, discal diffuse goiter, no, not Hashimoto, she had a Graves' disease. So diffuse goiter corresponding to Graves' disease and an encapsulated papillary cancer corresponding to the nodule, normal variant, classical variant. And the tumor broke not only through the capsule but spread extrathyroidal. So this was, it was an encapsulated form of papillary cancer but not follicular variant.
Hmm.
And the patient had not Hashimoto's thyroiditis, but Graves' disease. Graves. So I finished the cases to present. Any questions, comments to the today webinar? You are almost all unmuted, so if somebody will talk, please unmute yourself.
I would like to make just a small comment.
Please.
Regarding the TNM classification. Please. So, microscopic invasion has been taken from T3 to T1.
Yes. Downgraded only if downgraded. Only minimum has a downgraded.
But TNM classification is for, to my knowledge, mortality. And the American Thyroid Association classification for recurrence and persistence of the disease. The microscopic invasion is still intermediate risk. The microscopic invasion is still intermediate risk. So these are different concepts in terms of invasion. This is a important point in my opinion. I just wanted to emphasize.
Mm-hmm. Okay. How many classifications? As much different opinions, but I think that the TNM classification system is a worldwide accepted system, and it is very well established and states that patients younger than 55 years, even in the extent of gross extrathyroidal extension, have a more than 98% 10 years disease-free survival. So these are facts. In the former system, part of these patients belonged to stage 2 or stage 3. So this is well established. Maybe the Americans have a right, and I think that we can find some patients who are presented with stage 1 disease and have worse prognosis, but I quoted the TNM system. Comments from Gilles or Andrea to this question?
Well, this is a very challenging issue. What to do with the minimal extrathyroid extension, you know, every day in our practice, we are, you know, discussing in our multidisciplinary team if candidate patients with previous T3, minimal extrathyroidal extensions to radioiodine treatment or not. This probably is, from a practical point of view, the more challenging situation. And still, this is an unsolved issue. I know there are some group of pathologists working on a possible change of TNM classification in order to manage somehow to evaluate whether there's still a reason to consider minimal extension a prognostic factor, a worse prognostic factor. I think this is a very good point, and I would say that we need still data from the literature, and probably within, I don't know, within some years we will manage to know something more about this point.
And I have one more comment. The current data are based on patients who were treated with radioiodine. So we know that currently stage one patients were treated with radioiodine. We do not know whether these were not treated with radioiodine would have such a great prognosis. So these are not absolutely clear data, and most of the data came from highly experienced teams, and to the best of my knowledge, from 1990 to 1910, most if not all patients get radioiodine if they had extrathyroidal extension, even the minimal degree. And we have no data whether these patients would not get radioiodine, what prognosis they have. Other comments regarding Omicron, COVID? No comments? Okay. So I thank you for your participation, particularly for the participation of Andrea Frazoldati and Gilles Rus. And we will meet next Thursday, when we will hear two presentations on the thyroid system, one from Gilles Rus and another one from Cosimo Durante. So this will be not a type 1, but a type 2 webinar. And the edited form of this event will be present on the website on Sunday at latest. If no questions, answers, once more, thank you very much for your participation.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Thank you.
Good night.
Thank you.
Good night.
Bye.